matchless wisdom of his ways that mark the path of righteousness. His word a lamp unto my feet, his spirit teaching and guiding me.
Welcome to the Church at Clarendon. My name is Danielle Bridgeforth, and it is my humble delight and honor to serve as a senior pastor of our church located here in Arlington, Virginia. And I am so excited to welcome you to our service today. You're visiting us in the month of June. And if I can think of two words to describe June, it would be consecration and celebration. This month, we will take time to honor our deacons, fathers, and graduates, and we will highlight the importance, the impact, and the necessity of prayer. We will consecrate ourselves to God by renewing our faithfulness to God through prayer with our month-long prayer blitz. And every day, we will invite you to pray along with us. You don't need me to tell you that our society is at a critical juncture in our history. And the decisions that we make today, the answers to the questions that we give today, will truly impact the trajectory and determine where we go from here. And so with that thought, I sincerely ask that you would take seriously this invitation to pray intensely this month along with us. Because what we believe and know is that the prayers of the righteous are yet availing much. When we pray with repentant, open, and obedient hearts, God will hear us and will heal our land. Whether you are with us in the sanctuary on one of our in-person worship Sundays or you're worshiping with us virtually, we don't believe you're here by accident. We want you to know that God has something to say to you today. Our mission at the church at Clarendon is that we invite you to discover Christ and live a life of purpose and passion. We want you to know God by cultivating a growing and maturing relationship with Jesus. And we want you to live passionately and purposely every single day. I hope that you will plug in with us by downloading our app or signing up for our newsletter. And go ahead and make time to come into our hybrid Bible study or Sunday school classes. We have a lot of community events going on this month, and you don't want to miss anything. As always, I extend myself to you. If you need to meet with the pastor, want to be baptized, have questions about our community, or if there's some other way that we can support you, please don't hesitate to reach out to us via an email or a call to our church office. Again, thank you so much for visiting with us and worshiping with us today. Lean in and hear what God has to say. Clap your hands to the music and please enjoy the fellowship. I love you and I look forward to seeing you again really soon.
Good morning and welcome to the Church of Clarendon. We're excited that you have stopped by worship today, regardless if you're here in the sanctuary or if you're watching us online. We invite you to join in our hymn of the month, In the Garden. Thank you.
Hallelujah. I don't know, maybe we should keep that song for a whole nother month. I don't know. That one really got in my spirit. Welcome to the church at Clarendon. We are so delighted that you're here with us. That was our hymn of the month for the month of June as we've been focused on prayer in the garden. And I hope that that has also brought you hope this month to know that whenever you talk to God, God is there to speak with you. We're so delighted that you're with us today. And if you're in the sanctuary with us, would you mind standing on your feet as we go to our call to worship today? Coming from Psalm 34 from the New King James Version simply says, I will bless the Lord at all times, and praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear of it and be glad. But this is the verse I really like. And the psalmist says, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. And that's the invitation for us, whether you're in the sanctuary or viewing us online. Won't you bless the Lord with me this morning? Hallelujah. Welcome to worship.
Come on and bless the Lord with me.
Yeah.
Come on and bless the Lord with me. Sing together.
Come on and bless the Lord with me.
Come on and bless
the Lord.
God, for this day, we thank you, God, for a day that we have not seen. God, we thank you, God, for the many blessings that you've given us as we have woken up today and, God, been clothed, God, in our right mind, and we're here, God, to worship you. God, we pray that, God, that the prayers and petitions that are on our hearts, the things that are wearing at our souls, God, that there would be something that would be sung or said during this time of worship together that would bring comfort, that would bring peace, God, would bring assurance and hope. God, we are excited about the word that you have given to us through your vessel, our pastor, and we pray, God, that every word, God, is food for us to feast on in the coming week. God, we honor you. We worship you, God, in this day, and we give you all the thanks and praise. Amen.
Amen, amen. You may take your seats if you're in the sanctuary. We want to again say welcome to everybody for joining us. In particular, if this is your very first time that you're worshiping with us, if someone shared our app or if you found us on social media, we want you to know that you are not here by accident. God does not work in coincidences. God is very intentional in our lives. And so where you are today is where you are supposed to be. And so we want you to know we extend ourselves to you, and we want you to feel very, very welcomed here in our worship service. We want to say happy birthday and happy anniversary to all of those who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries this week. We had several people celebrating birthdays as we get to the end of June. And as always, we thank God for your life and for your ministry and pray God's richest blessings be upon you and your marriage. And we are asking that this would be your very best year yet. No matter how good things have been, God can always do better. And so we ask that you would just be open to how God would want to meet you. A couple of things that I want to highlight in terms of announcements. I said in the welcome video for June that we were going to be celebrating our graduates in June, but we just didn't get to it. It was just too much stuff going on. And so we are actually going to honor our graduates on the second Sunday in July, July 10th, which is the next time that we will be gathered together in person for our worship service. And so at this point, we want to ask all of those who have graduated or been promoted to the next level of school, starting from pre-K all the way through the graduate school, you can go to our website and you can fill out a graduate recognition form. Let us know what you're doing, where you graduated from, any kind of awards that you may have received in recognition, and where you're going to school so that we can celebrate all of our graduates on July 10th. We want to hear from you. We can't celebrate you if we don't have your information, so go ahead and fill that out so we'll have it in a timely way. And if you're able, submit a picture. And for those of you who can come on that day, we look forward to seeing you in person in the sanctuary that day. As likewise, I want to let you know that also on July 10th, we are going to have baptisms. Some of you might remember that we were supposed to baptize two individuals last month, and at the last minute on Saturday, they both got sick. And so now we're going to come back around and hopefully be able to baptize them on July 10th. And so that's an opportunity for anyone else. If you have not been baptized, if you called on the name of the Lord and you want to become a member of our church, you can let us know and we will get you baptized so that you can finish that last part to be able to be a full member and to just show outwardly what's already happened inwardly in terms of your conversion and your faith in God. And so, of course, we know that today is June 26th, and so we're always also almost made it down to the end of our month of prayer, but we're still praying with our prayer blitz. Today's theme is financial literacy, freedom, financial freedom, and financial breakthrough. And so continuing to pray, and I ask that you pray all the way through the end of the month, finishing out each of those days. And I'll say a little bit more about this when the prayer time, but we had a wonderful time for our 24-hour community prayer vigil just the other day, and I'll mention more about that in a few minutes. But with that, we will move now to our time of giving. We thank you for your generosity to our church. Thank you for your giving to our ministries, both our general fund as well as to our benevolence ministry. We have been able to help so many individuals and continue to have ministry go forward here seamlessly, even all throughout the time of the pandemic. And that's because we have individuals who are very committed to God, and they show their commitment to God through their giving to this local church. We don't take that for granted, because there are many people who give, and we are thankful for them. You can give by going to our website. You can text to give. You can mail your gift here, and you can also go to our church app and give there. And however you do so, we want to say thank you. Now let's pray together. God, we thank you for the opportunity to give, realizing that we give as a sign of obedience and faith because you have given to us. Surely, God, you have blessed us in many ways, and it is only right that we would give back to you by giving to your church, God, so that your ministry could go forward, so that others might know that Jesus saves, and Jesus saves to the utmost. So we thank you for these gifts and for these givers. We thank you, God, for the wisdom and the courage you've given our church to utilize these funds in ways that will take the gospel far and wide to those near and those who will never meet, so that they might know the love and the grace and the peace of Jesus. Bless us now, oh God. Bless this gift, bless these givings, and make us a blessing. We pray in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, amen, and amen. Y'all sound like a Baptist church up in here.
We bring a sacrifice of praise.
It's a good thing to praise the Lord and to lift up the name of the Most High. We're moving now to our time of prayer, and we have been continuing to pray this entire month especially. And we were here starting at 12 noon on this past Friday, and we were here all day and all night until about 1 o'clock yesterday afternoon. Our doors were open and we were praying for our community and with our community. And what a tremendous time it was. And people were asking if the pastor was here all 24 hours. I was. I did go home and get a sweatshirt at about 7 a.m. so people would see me in the same clothes I had on the day before, but it's all good. But over that time, over that 24 hours, we really interacted with our community in a really special way. We had about 70 people or so who came in and out of our doors. The last person came about 5 a.m. That was an interesting conversation. But it was good that people wanted to be prayed for and with and were willing and open. And really what we were just trying to do is in the days and times in which we're living, trying to make sure people know that God is available and accessible to them. That it doesn't matter where you've been, doesn't matter what you've done, doesn't matter what your life conditions are, God loves you and God is available to you. And the church should be a place where people can always come and experience the love of God. And so I want to thank those of you who were here, who came throughout any time of that 24-hour period. I was not here by myself for 24 hours. There was someone here with me the whole time. There were many people here. And those who were doing the late night shift especially, I'm grateful for the conversations and the prayers we had. And we also had a service on Friday, which we live streamed. And we closed out yesterday with another service, which we did not live stream, but it was really good, full of testimonies for those who were here. And so we're continuing to pray, but I want to thank you. That's going to be something we do annually during our month of prayer, that 24-hour community prayer vigil. And even those in the community were saying thank you and that we should do this because they want to see the lights on here at the church all night, especially on Friday night. Boy, I tell you, Friday nights in Clarendon. It's something. It is something. But I'm glad that I was here, and I'm glad that you all were here, and thank you for praying with us. We also want to continue to pray, and one of the things that we had at the prayer vigil was a big sheet of paper where we invited people to write their prayer requests and their praise reports, and that's still out in our sanctuary, and I'll leave that out there for the next several weeks so we can add to it and check off what God has met. And so we're praying for all the needs of our community. We're remembering what happened in Afghanistan and the earthquake last week. I've been mentioning to you the wildfires that are going on out west. Of course, we're always praying for families, those who are grieving, those who are overcoming and dealing with addictions, those who are dealing with depression and sadness, those looking for jobs, and we celebrate those who have new jobs. We had some of our police officers here with us over the 24 hours of prayer, and we want to continue to thank God for our first responders, our police officers, our military personnel serving domestically and abroad, but those who take care of the behind-the-scenes things that we don't see, but we just know it gets done. Of course, we're always praying for our community leaders. Both Pastor Tesfai and Pastor Abel came and prayed with us during our prayer vigil, and so we know our community is united in that way. We're also praying for traveling mercies. We have some in our community that will be traveling back to their homes this coming week. We're praying that God would bless them with safe travel and that they would get there safely. And we're just asking that God would be with us. Certainly, you did not miss this week. On Friday, while we were praying, we got the news that the Supreme Court had overturned the Roe v. Wade decision. And so that was very distracting and distressful for many people. And while on some sides, on the other side, people were celebrating. And all of those emotions are appropriate. And we understand why there's a difference in terms of understanding what happens regarding abortion. And we recognize the sanctity of life. And we also recognize the need for safety and health care and for human rights and women's rights. And so it's not just about one thing. Is it morally wrong or right? It's a myriad of ways that we need to look at this situation as a nation and deal with it. And what I thought about was what God said in Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6, simply saying that it's not by power nor by might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. And I bring that up only because we have to be careful when we force our way and do what we have the power to do without making sure we have the heart and mind of God. And even when we are on the right side, we also need to make sure that God is a God of love and humility. And so gloating and attacking people because they think differently than us is never pleasing to God. And so what we want to do as a nation is be a nation that comes together, even in our differences, and doesn't transact in hate, but transacts in humility and love. Because the fact of the matter is, some very good laws that have been on the books in this country have been very bad for people historically. And we know that those laws have been applied and misapplied and have hurt certain individuals. And that is not over. It's still happening. And so there's still a need for us to pray. There's still a need for us to trust God. There's still a need for us to seek the wisdom of God and to lean on the Spirit of God. I hope that you will continue to do that along with me. And now I will ask that you would lift your quiet prayer requests to the Lord. Jesus. We call upon the name of Jesus because your word declares that it is at the name of Jesus that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that you are Lord. We come praying in the name of Jesus because the name of Jesus is a strong tower, a safe place where we can go and find safety and help for our souls. Today, God, we lift before you ourselves, our community, our families, our nation, and even our world. The many prayer requests and praise reports that we have been able to join together in lifting over these last 36, 48 hours specifically. We're grateful, God, for how we have seen you move, for how we've seen you let people get out of the hospital and open doors for people to get new jobs, and even bringing people into the church that hadn't been in the church in a very, very long time to know that they could feel welcomed and that your presence would be here. We thank you, God, that you are wiser than we are. And so we're looking to you and asking that you would give us your wisdom and your strength. God, help our nation to not be so divided. Help us, God, to not feel like we have to hate those with which we disagree. Help us, God, to not overlook and ignore our differences, because our differences are beautiful, because you made us differently. But help us to learn, God, how to see you even in the midst of our differences, because we all bear the image of God, the Imago Dei, because we were all created in your likeness and in your image and by your hand. So thank you, God, for how you have watched over us, for how you, God, have healed us. Today we pray for those who are in need of comfort and grief, those who have said farewell to loved ones and friends. We pray for families, God, that are dealing with end-of-life situations, for caring for loved ones, or for teenagers, God, who are dealing with depression and disappointment, struggling with whether or not they want to live. God, will you let them know that you have plans that are so much greater than they can see right now? Help us, God, not to get so stuck in what we feel right now that we make permanent decisions that will be harmful to our future. God, we're looking to you to give us wisdom and strength and hope and healing and help in our time of trouble. Those who are hurting today, God, meet them right where they are. And we, Lord, don't only want to be a community that prays. We, God, want to be a community that practically meets the needs and comes alongside and walks with others no matter where they find themselves. And so will you empower us to know how to do that even today. Thank you, Lord, for taking all that we are and using it for your glory and for your goodness. And today, God, we decide that we don't know what's best for our lives, so we give our lives to you so that you can use us. In Jesus' name, we pray. Hallelujah.
myself away so you can use me. I give myself away.
I give myself away.
We are grateful that we don't have to figure out life by ourselves or on our own. When we're honest, we can admit that the questions and the dilemmas of life are so much bigger and so much harder than we could ever manage by ourselves. Knowing, God, that we would need you, thank you for making a way for us to live with you, not only in eternity, but right now. But God, we recognize that in order for us to have the benefits that come from being in relationship with you, we have to simply allow ourselves to be loved, to be lorded, and to be cared for by you. So help us today, even where we might be resisting you and thinking somewhere in the back of our minds that we're smart enough or our pedigree is good enough, we have enough money. Help us to know, God, that none of those things matter, because we all equally need you, and you are equally available to us all. As we go into these moments of preaching and teaching, let the words of my mouth and the collective meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, for you alone are our strength and redeemer. Amen. Will you do me a favor and praise God right there for our praise and worship ministry? Thank God for them, and thank God for our multimedia ministry and all the things that they do each and every day and each and every week to make sure that we're able to have service, whether we are just here with the team or whether we have the entire congregation gathered with us or part of the congregation gathered with us. Today we are moving to the end of our month-long focus on prayer. And yesterday I was very moved by many testimonies that I received and heard during that 11 o'clock hour, our 24 of our 24 hours of prayer, where members of our community and our church were sharing what their experience had been through the prayer blitz and even through the 24-hour prayer vigil. And what I recognize is that there are many people in our community who are very committed to prayer. And whether you know it or not, your life depends on the prayers of righteous people. And whether or not you know it or not, you should be praying for someone else as a righteous person. And so this month we have talked about the right way to pray and the right time to pray. And today I want to share with you about the right people with which we need to pray. Even as we look at this passage that's very familiar, from Matthew chapter 26. Matthew 26, going to start my reading in verse 36 and take it down to verse 46. I'm reading in the New Revised Standard Version. And as has become our practice, I would ask that you would stand in recognition and honor for God's word. Matthew 26, verse 36 through 46 from the New Revised Standard. And it says this: then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that's James and John, and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." And going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, after he woke him up, of course, "So could you not stay awake with me 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial or temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Hallelujah. Again, he went away for the second time and prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." And again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." You may take your seats. For the brief time that we have together, I want to speak with you from the topic the prayer community that we need. The prayer community that we need. I have said many times before, and I'm sure I will say many times again, that we all need community. God created us to live together and to walk together in life. We were not created to do things on our own and to be isolated. We were not created to carry our burdens and our concerns by ourselves. We were not created to win victories or to suffer defeats alone. No, God created us for community. I remember several years ago, I read an article that was done on as they had evaluated different sports teams throughout history. And what the researcher and writer had found was that even with teams, people who had on the same jersey, that there was a distinction in terms of how they interacted and the success they had based on how connected they were. And they looked at the fact of how when someone fell, if their teammate went over and grabbed them, how when they made a shot or threw a pass, if their teammate high-fived them or patted them on the bottom to say good job or encourage them. And what they noticed was that the teams that experienced the most success were the teams that had the most and closest level of connectivity. Meaning whether or not they were winning or losing, the difference that really was made is that they were together and that they could even suffer a defeat more easily and better when they knew that they had someone on their team who yet believed in them and who was on their side. And I wish that we as humans could really understand what some of the best teams throughout history have come to recognize, and that is that it's not always about the skill level or the behavior of the individual. It's really about whether or not we can come together and maximize our strengths to overcome whatever opposition might be against us. Friends, we need and were created for community. And it's often difficult for us to know the right people to be in community with. Sometimes we don't know, is this a good choice? Is this person someone I should trust? And so it's important that we recognize that there are certain characteristics that need to be embodied in the people that we seek to be in community with. We see this even in our text today, but we can learn it all throughout life. And I want to suggest to you that the people that we need to be in community with should have at least three characteristics, but don't miss this. These are really the characteristics that you and I should have so that people will want to be in community with us. Because someone says that you shouldn't look for somewhere else that which you are not willing to give and offer yourself. Somebody will get that later on with their thinking about it. Like, stop looking for someone to be loyal to you when you are disloyal. Stop looking for someone to be generous to you when you are stingy. We have to first make sure that we embody certain principles and characteristics so then we can build community with those people. It'll be like a magnet. What we put out, hallelujah, will come back to us. And so the three things I think that people we should look for to be and to receive in community is, first of all, trust. That we need to be people who trust one another and who are trustworthy. Some of us know the pain of broken trust and betrayal. Jesus knew that pain. In fact, the understanding of the prayer that Jesus prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane when he asked for God to let the cup pass from him, it wasn't that he didn't want humanity to be saved. It was really more so that Jesus didn't want to have to go through the betrayal of having those who were closest to him turn their back on him. Because Jesus understood that an important characteristic that we should seek from those whom we are in community with and that we should offer to community is trust. And so these are things you have to think about in the quietness of your own heart. Are you trustworthy? Is your word your bond? Can someone say that if they say they're going to do it, if they say they're going to be there, they're going to be there? Or does your word and your reliability fly and change with the wind? I love people who say they're going to come and then they just change their mind just because it wasn't convenient. And then they don't even tell you that they ain't coming no more. Man, I tell you, we need to be trustworthy. But not only is trust an important characteristic that we should seek from those with whom we're in community and that we should seek to provide, but we also see in our text that an important characteristic we need is transparency. The fact of the matter is, you and I can't really build community with others with whom we are not honest and transparent. Too many marriages, too many individuals, too many teams are breaking down and have broken down simply because people are not transparent. People won't tell you what they really think. They won't tell you what they really feel. They won't let you know what's going on in their minds. They'll just keep on faking and shucking and driving and smiling, even though things are not going well. And some of us also know the pain of someone presenting one way and then showing up and doing something different. What I appreciate about Jesus is that Jesus, even in his brief time on earth, 33 years, he was able to develop community with people that was strong enough, that was real enough, and that was trustworthy enough where he could simply be transparent. Here is the God of the universe who's able to say to some of his closest friends, my heart is broken, I'm depressed, and I don't like life right now. And I wonder how much better our world would be if we were to be able to create community where people could simply be honest in their brokenness, where people could come and say, it's okay to not be okay. You don't have to have it all together. You don't have to have all the answers. You don't have to look like you're strong enough. It's all right for you to say, I don't know. It's okay for you to say, I don't like where I am. I don't like what I did. I'm upset with what's going on. That's what we have going on right now. And even though we might know something is right in our minds, it's so unhealthy to deny the emotional response to the thing that you know is right. What do you mean, Pastor? Like, even though I understand that I should do certain things, I might still grieve and be upset about having to do this. Sometimes we don't like what we need to do, and we should not deny ourselves the right to grieve and to feel even as we go about making the right decisions. Jesus was never going to not go to the cross. But what I appreciate about Jesus in this text and this story that we are recounting today is that Jesus was transparent enough to say, this is hard and I'm hurting. And for someone today, I want you to know that God has a community for you. God has people that you can come and simply be transparent with, and you can be transparent for. But lastly, when I talk about the type of characteristics that we need to embody in those that we seek community with and that we should bring to community, not only do we need to be trusting and transparent, but lastly, we need to be truthful. And you see the truthfulness in our text today in a rather ironic and weird kind of way, but I don't want you to miss this. I understand that Jesus knew these 11 men that were with him because Jesus had journeyed with them throughout the Bible. The text tells us that Jesus handpicked these brothers. He knew their weaknesses. He knew their strengths. He knew their proclivities. He understood where they would be a little off. He knew Peter was a little bit, temperamental and quick to the draw. He knew that Peter would say he could do it, but then ultimately he was going to deny him. But I appreciate the fact that Jesus allowed these brothers to be truthful and honest. Jesus picked these guys to go and pray with him, and then they fell asleep. But this is what I appreciate. They were just honest. They were truthful. And if you and I are going to be able to build quality community with others, we're going to have to just be honest. Stop lying, but just be honest about what you need. The fact of the matter is, they were tired, and they fell asleep. And I would rather have someone walking with me in life who will let me know, yes, Danielle, I can do that, instead of lying to me and saying they can't when they know that they have no intention or ability to do it. Truthfulness is an important part, important characteristic that we need in community. We need people whose yes is yes and whose no is no and whose I don't know is okay, I don't know. Jesus understood the men who were with him. He handpicked them. He understood that they would be honest with him even when they were failing, even when they were falling asleep. There's no response or excuse in our text that comes back from Peter, James, or John. Doesn't seem like they were trying to say, oh, Jesus, what happened was, those brothers were just saying, hey, man, I fell asleep. And it might not look positive, but it's really good to know that Jesus chose people, even who were imperfect, but he walked with them. Because that means that I know that I can be imperfect and find people to walk with me, and I can walk with others. I want us to understand that not only do we need community, we need people who are trusting and transparent and truthful to walk with in life, but more so than even that, we need to be in community with those who are willing and who know how to pray. I need people who will shoot the breeze with me. I need people who will go and hang out with me, who will take trips and go to concerts with me. But more than all of that, I need people in my life. You need people in your life who are willing to pray and who know how to pray. And that's really what our text is about today. That Jesus, when he gets to the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus, when he gets to this place of his most dire need and distressing circumstance in life, that he didn't just ask for them to eat with him. They had already been to the upper room. They had shared a meal together. He didn't just ask for them to simply kind of hang out with him. No, Jesus chose those who he knew and he expected to pray with and for him. And friends, what I want you to understand today is that there is a prayer community that we all need. That's the reason why we opened up our sanctuary for the last 24 hours, because I don't want this to just be a place where people can come and sing songs. I want our community and I want our church to know that when they come here, they can have somebody who will pray with them and pray for them. Let me share with you three things that I see about those who we need to be in community with, in prayer community with. And we understand that Jesus, who was both fully God and fully human, Jesus himself gives us insight into just how important it is to have a prayer community. Jesus had a prayer community. Do you? One of the things I want you to know that we need in our prayer community, and it's in our text, is that first of all, we need people who will simply be with us. If you're in our app or on our website this morning, I want you to know that you can get the prayer, you can get the sermon fill-in notes of this sermon there. It's right there where you are viewing it in the app, and you can follow along. People, we need people in our prayer community who can simply be with us. I want you to note in Matthew chapter 26, verse 36, that Jesus says these words, "Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, 'Sit here.'" Understanding that the first thing that Jesus needed in a prayer community was people who were simply willing to be with him. I don't know about you. I don't know if you've ever gone through a situation in life when words escaped you, or when you were too sad to know what to say, or when you really didn't have anything you could do, but yet and still you wanted to be together with those with whom you were in community. It happened to me recently when a dear friend of mine's mother passed away. She called me one morning and let me know that her mom had passed away the night before. And she hung up the phone, and I was so heartbroken that all I could do was get in my car and drive 2 hours simply to be with her. I didn't say much. I just cried with her when she cried. I didn't do much because there were people all around who were doing things, but I was just there because, friends, if you have a prayer community, you need those that you can trust to simply just be with you. It's not all about what you say and what you do, but can you just be with people? Some people can't be with you awkwardly in silence, but sometimes you know that there's nothing that you can say, but your ministry of presence is all that's needed. Jesus took all 11 of these brothers to the Garden of Gethsemane, and he said to the first eight, will you just sit here? I'm going to go and pray over there. But just the knowledge that you're here helps me and will encourage my heart and my spirit. And I wonder today if there's anybody that you are in community with who you simply need to go and be with. Not because you can fix their issue, not because you know the answer, not because you have the money to pay their bills, not because you can undo what's been done, but can you and I simply be with people? Because that is the type of prayer community that we need. We need a prayer community with people who can simply be with us. But I don't want you to miss this. Not only did Jesus have those that he simply asked to be with him, but secondly, we also need to be in a prayer community with people who will not only be with us, but people who will be watchful. People who will be watchful. Verse 37 says that after Jesus said to the first eight, sit here while I go over there and pray, it says in verse 37, he took with him now Peter, James, and John and began to be grieved and agitated. And then he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me. Jesus had those that he knew were just with him, and then he also had some that he asked to not just be with them, but he asked them specifically to be watchful. And this idea of being watchful has to do with us being alert. This has to do with us being attentive. This has to do with us being intentional in our prayer relationship so that I'm not only with you, but I'm able to anticipate and to ask the right questions and to provide watchfulness in life. And I don't want you to think that this watchfulness just means that you're staying awake. No, we need to be watchful for the way that the enemy might come to distract us. We need to have people in our prayer community who can warn us when we are going down the wrong path, who will say, be careful, watch your step, like mama and daddy did when we were little. When we're about to run across the street and maybe get hit by a car, we need those who are watching us who can pull us back and say, hey, hold up, don't do that, don't go there. Being watchful means that I won't fall asleep, not only literally, but also figuratively. The way and the reason that we have had some of the injuries in our country and in our world is not because it couldn't have been prevented, but simply because some people weren't watching. Sometimes we're not watchful, and Jesus said, I need Peter, James, and John. These were the three in his inner circle. These were the three he knew the best. These were the three he knew the most. These were the three that he was counting on, and he said to them, will you stay awake with me? Will you watch my back? Will you look out for my best interest? Will you make sure that I am able to fulfill the will of God for my life? We have to be with people, and we also need to be watchful. We have to make sure we stay alert. We have to make sure that we don't fall asleep. One of the people who was here with me over the late night hours of the 24 hours of prayer is a dear friend and brother of mine who I've known for over 25 years. He drove all the way over from Laurel. He got here at about 1 o'clock and stayed till about 8 a.m. because he said, I don't want you to be there by yourself during those late night hours. I'm gonna come and pray and watch with you and look out for the community alongside you. We need those who are in our prayer community who won't just come and be with us, but they'll come and be alert. They'll be watchful. They'll be attentive to our needs. They'll be able to sense what's going on, and they'll jump in to help us. But not only that, not only when we're talking about the type of people, the prayer community that we need, do we need people who will simply be with us, and do we need people who will be watchful? But third and lastly, I think in our text we see the importance of having people who will help to bear our weaknesses. People who will help to bear our weaknesses. In verse 37, 38, it says Jesus, he started to say to them, Peter, James, and John, I'm deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me. And then going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and he began to pray, "My Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, you want." And verse 40 says, then he came back to the disciples, the same ones he'd asked to watch for him, and he found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "Could you not stay awake with me for 1 hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial or temptation, for the spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." And what Jesus is asking, showing us through this interaction, is that not only do we need people to be with us and people who will be watchful, but we need to have in our prayer community those who will help to bear our weaknesses, those who will help to lift up our bowed down heads, those who can take our weaknesses and who, in the midst of seeing that we are weak, will not abandon us and leave us, but those who will say, "I will share my strength with you." We need people in our prayer community that when we don't feel like praying, if you've never been there, keep living. When you don't have the words to pray, and sometimes even those of us who love the Lord still don't know what to say. Even sometimes of us who've been walking with the Lord for a long time, our emotions can become numb by life. We can become confused by what to do, and we don't have it. But if we're in community with others who can help to bear our weaknesses, then we can be strong, not in our own strength, but in the strength of others. Jesus said to Peter, "Hey, brother, pay attention. You have to help me to bear my weaknesses, because one day soon, you're going to have to build community with those who can help you to bear your weaknesses." And that's really the question today, is do you have people in your community that know how and are willing to pray? Jesus went on to pray two more times, and then he kept finding his friends and brothers asleep. But what I appreciate about Jesus is even though those who he called to be with him and to be watchful and to bear his witnesses weren't perfect, it didn't stop Jesus from doing what he had been created and called to do. And friends, really, that's the final point. If I was going to make a fourth point, it would be that we need a prayer community that will push us to do the will of God. We need people who will be able to know our gifts, our talents, and who will go and say, "You have to go forward even though it's hard. You have to keep pushing even though you want to quit." I may have told you this story before, but in my final year of college when I was at JMU, I always knew I wanted to be a lawyer. That had been my dream since I was in seventh grade. But the reality is I applied to about 7 or 8 law schools, and I got denied from all but one of them. And after having taken the LSAT the first time, I didn't really get the grade or the result that I wanted, and I had decided in my short-sightedness that this was too hard. This must not be what I'm supposed to do. Even though it's been my dream since I was a child, I'm not going to go to law school. I'm going to quit and give up and figure out something else to do. And I remember I was with 3 of my closest friends, and we're still close to this day. And I began to share with them on a Tuesday night, and I told them what I just told you. I said, "Hey guys, I didn't get into these law schools. My LSAT score wasn't good. I guess what that means is I'm not supposed to be a lawyer, so I'm going to quit and do something else." And one by one, each of my 3 friends who knew my purpose, who believed in me more than I believed in myself in that moment, began to help me to bear my weakness. And they said to me, "Nah, DB, that's not the answer. You got to keep going. You got to take the LSAT again. You can't quit. This is all you've ever talked about, is being a lawyer. We won't let you not go and do and finish your destiny and live out your dream." And after my friends got finished talking to me, they surrounded me and they prayed with me and for me. And I want you to know, you already know the end of the story. I took the LSAT. I got into Howard Law School. I graduated from Howard Law with honors. And I went on to have a wonderful legal career for 10 years. Because I had some people in my community at the right time that when I was weak, they bore my weaknesses for me. When I couldn't see my way out, they saw beyond where I was then to where I would be. And friends, today, what I'm saying to you and I is we need to be in that type of prayer community. We need to be in a prayer community with people who will be with us, people who will watch out for us, and people who will bear our weaknesses so that we can fulfill the will of God. All I'm trying to say is that we need people who can declare with us, I need you and you need me, not just to make it, but to survive.
You need me.
Thank you, God.
We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive.
That's the sermon. You and I need one another. We need a prayer community that will help us to get through life and to fulfill the will of God.
Survive.
I'm so glad that Jesus had that, because you do know how the story ends. Jesus left the Garden of Gethsemane. He went all the way up Golgotha's hill. The Bible says that they made him carry his own cross. They impaled him on that cross with nails in his hands and nails in his feet. They put the cross up high. Jesus died for you and I. After saying, Father, forgive them. After saying, I'm going to go and be with Jesus. But I'm so glad that Jesus even wasn't alone in death. Because the Bible says that Joseph of Arimathea came and asked for his body and took his body off the cross and put it in a borrowed tomb. And then even on Sunday morning, he had some people who were expecting to find a dead body in the tomb. But hallelujah, Jesus wasn't in the tomb anymore, because he got up with all power in his hands. And that same power that raised Jesus from the grave is the same power that is drawing you and I into community, first with God and then with one another. And today, friends, we need community, and we need a prayer community that will go with us and stand by us and who will say, you're important to me. I need you to survive. People who will say, decision time. Will you open yourself up to community? And even if you're already on the team, it's more than just showing up. It's, will you be involved and engaged in life and in relationship? We offer Christ to you today, and I invite you to stand to your feet if you're here in the sanctuary with us, and I invite you to share in this prayer of salvation. For we have to be in relationship with God first and foremost, and then we can trust God to show us those that we should be in community with. So today, let's lift our voices and pray together. Dear very first time today, will you let us know that so that we can get you baptized on July 10th? So that we can get you plugged in and you can become a member of our church and start coming to Bible study and Sunday school. For it's not just about being in the body of Christ. You also have to be in community with those who are with those who will be with you, those who will bear your weaknesses, and those who will be watchful along with you. In worship today. Thank you for praying along with us. We are continuing to pray in our prayer blitz for the next 4 days of the month. Tomorrow's prayer focus is the incarcerated and their families and those dealing with any forms of abuse, neglect, or bondage. We're going to be in recess from our intercessory prayer tomorrow at 1 o'clock, but we will be on the phone on Wednesdays at 7 and on Wednesday night for Bible study. And so until then, I'll be praying for you. Our spoken benediction is as we go, and I invite you to lift your voices together as we go. As we go, we give thanks for God's word. We affirm that God is all-knowing, all-seeing, and ever-present. We desire to be Christ's hands, feet, and mouthpieces in the world so that all may know that Jesus is Lord. May we be instruments of God's love, we pray. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord smile on you, your circumstances and relationships. May God give you wisdom, grace, peace, and power to be in community with others, to be in a prayer community with others, where you can have those who will be with you.